Graphs can really help us see trends and behavior of numerical data. So what we're going to do is look at a few different ways that we can graph numerical data. And then what we'll work through in these next few videos is how to interpret those graphs and what are they telling us. The first graph we're going to look at is a dot plot. So what we're going to use for example here are these 15 exam scores from a made-up statistics class. So our data, we have our 15 scores, and we want to make a dot plot. To start our dot plot, what we're going to need is a number line. And with your number lines, you want kind of a consistent scale. So like the distance between these tick marks should be roughly consistent. I mean, this is hand-drawn. If you want to be more exact, you can use a ruler. And what should also be occurring is your units should be consistent, meaning that when we cross this distance, it's a distance of 10 between the two values, and it stays a distance of 10. So we're not switching kind of the scale as we move along our number line. So we have our number line, and with that, we can get an idea of where these values land. Now at the dot plot, we're graphing exactly where a value's landing. So if we were going to graph 31 from our data set, we look at where 30 is, and we just estimate that 31 would land about right there. So we place a dot just above the number line where that would land. And then 62 would be somewhere about there, 65. So you just estimate where it would land, and then draw a dot above that point on the number line. So this shows us what happens on kind of an individual basis with our values. When we have repeats, so like we have 82 occurs twice, you stack the dots at the same spot. So stack identical values. But other than that, if they're not identical, they get their own space on the number line. And then 87, 88, 89, and 94, 95, 98, 100. So that's our dot plot. It's great for a small set of data. If we get too many dots, it can show an overall trend, but it gets kind of messy to see what's happening overall. But for a small data set, it's wonderful. Now, as we kind of think about what if we had larger data sets, how can we group things and get an idea of the trend, our next step would be the stem and leaf plot. Now, stem and leaf plot is a way to get an idea of how the values spread on a number line with just looking at the numerical values. So there's two parts to stem and leaf plot. You make the stems and the leaves. It depends on the units of your data in terms of what you use as stems or leaves. For us, since our data is all made up of values with a tens place and a ones place, mostly only the 100 has a 100ths place, but to kind of fit all of our data or most of our data, we have a tens and ones place. So the stem is always going to be the larger part of it. So for us, we're going to have the stem represent the tens digits. So because we're spanning 31 up to 100, it's like we're starting in the 30s. So right here is where our stems go. And we're basically saying we could have 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. Now something to note is if we look at our data, we actually don't have anything in the 40s or 50s, but that's okay. That's actually very important. As we can see from our dot plot, it's important to see this gap here where there isn't any data, because that tells us that something special is happening with that 31 right there. So we want to see these gaps. So even though there isn't anything in the 40s or 50s, we want to include those two values on our stem and leaf plot. Now the leaves are going to represent the ones digits, and we're going to list the leaves over here. When you list the leaves, they should be increasing. So you start with your smallest leaf and then increase, and also be sure to list repeats. So we'll see that come through when we get to it. So for that data value of 31, we have our 30 on the left-hand side here. So to represent 31, we'd put that right there. 40s, we don't have anything. And what you want to be careful of is do not put a zero if there's nothing there. If you write zero like that, that's telling us that we have a data value of 40, because we have a stem of 4, leaf of 0, that would make a value of 40. But we don't have that. So what you do is just leave it blank. So we have nothing there for 40s, nothing there for 50s. For 60s, we have 62 and 65. So a list of 2, and then just next to it, write a 5. So it would be read as 62 and then 65. And then for the 70s, we have a 70, so we'd put a 0 there and a 76. For the 80s, we have a lot in the 80s, so we'd have 81. And then we have 2 values of 82, so what you would do is you'd write the 2 twice to represent that we can read 82 through 2 times. 7, 88, 89, then we have a 94, 95, and 98, and then we have a 100. So reading a stem and leaf plot gives you an idea of our different values, how it's organized. What we could see is at the top of the stem and leaf plot, that's going to describe your minimum value. So your smallest number is coming through there as 31. And then as you read down on the stem and leaf plot, your values are increasing. So if you look at the end here, that's going to hold your maximum value. And we have this maximum value of 100. So you can see how the values increase. So that if our data, say, wasn't in order at the beginning, now we could see the values in order. We can also get an idea of frequency in terms of where are a lot of values happening. Like we can see in the 80s, we have a lot of values occurring in the 80s there. So that's where the bulk of our data is. And then we can also see that gap of information again, where there's nothing between 31 and 62. So you can start reading it, even though it doesn't look like a graph, it is describing the numerical data graphically. The next two graphs we want to talk about is the histogram and the relative frequency histogram. And these two are very similar to each other. With the histogram, there's something called bin widths that we need to think about. These are also called classes or class width. What this tells us is kind of how far do we want to span the grouping for our data. So in this case, they're saying we're going to use a bin width of 10. So that means how we're going to divide our data values by 10s, which is how we separated our stem and leaf plot. But if the bin width was 5s, then we jump by 5s. So like it would go 30 to 35 would grab stuff, 35 to 40, so on and so forth. So 60 to 65, 65 to 70, just tells us how we divide our data. So what we're going to do is grouping by 10s, we're going to divide by the 10s values. So we have our 30s, there's our 60s, 70s, our 80s, 90s, and then we have something in the 100s. So because of that bin width of 10, that's how we're dividing up those numbers. Now, making our histogram, we're going to have an x and y axis. Along the y axis, we'll be collecting frequency. Which frequency is just another word for count. It's like we're counting how many values. So if we just make a number for our scale there, typically these will go by ones. However, if you have a larger and larger data set, you can adjust these just like in algebra where you could jump by twos or just set a unit and separate the numbers that way. Then along the x-axis, this is where we're going to actually write about our data, which in this case are the exam scores. And we're going to be moving by tens. So I could start numbering here, like we're starting at 0, and then this would be 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, so on and so forth. However, I'm actually going to fix those numbers because there's nothing between 0 and 30. I mean, this isn't a terrible way to start it, and you absolutely could graph it this way. This graph is actually made to not be large enough to fit it because I want to show this example where what if our data starts higher up on the number line, in that we don't want to actually show this space here where nothing's happening. We don't have any data down there. What you can do is adjust your graph. So say we want to start at 30 and then go 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. This works great. However, what we have to show is that we have inconsistent units right here. Like after 30, it's great. It's always jumping by tens. But before 30, we have an issue right here because that's saying that distance is 30 and then it changes to tens, which doesn't work. So you just need to draw a little symbol here. It's kind of a little zigzag there or a graph break that just says we're skipping over information. There's nothing there. So we can start our graph at that point in the number line. All right, so now we start drawing bars. And what we need to be careful of is there's something called a bar chart, and this is not a bar chart. Histogram is specific to numerical data values. We look at bar chart when we talk about categorical variables. So just be careful of that this is not a bar chart. This is a histogram. So in the 30s, we have one data value. So if we're counting how many data values fit that range of 30 to 40, we have one. So what that means is we draw a bar up to one to show we have one data value between 30 and 40. 40 to 50, we don't have anything. 50 to 60, we don't have anything, so we just skip. And then in the 60s, we have two data values. So what we'll show is between 60 and 70, we'd have a bar of height of 2 to show two data values in between there. 70 to 76, we have two data values. Now, something I want you to notice here is that data value of 70, in terms of looking at the graph, it's on the edge here. So when it's on the number line, like that, where it's technically, if we were drawing a dot plot, it would be landing right there at 70. It kind of looks like it could be a part of two different bins. That's what we're graphing here, these different bins. And the rule goes, it's called the right-hand rule. And it says that if a number lands on the edge of a number line, a value on the edge goes in the right-hand bin. So, with that said, with 70, it's grouping correctly here. It should be grouped together with that 76 to represent being part of the 70s. So, where it's landing on the edge here, we just want to make sure that while we would have drawn a dot right there at 70, it's being graphed in this right-hand bin. So 70 and 76 together gives us a height of 2, and that'll be our bar right there. In the 80s, we have 6 data values, so we'll have a height of 6 here. And then in the 90s, we'll have 3 data values. And then the 100s, we have one data value. So a histogram is great for when you have a lot of data. Because if you imagine, say I had 200 exam scores instead, this is a concise way to graph those numbers together in that we create these bins to show how many data values fit within each bin. Now, something important about these bins is the number range that's actually occurring here, along with this right-hand rule, with the right-hand rule saying that if we had something at 40 right here, it'd actually be graphed on this side. Technically, what's happening with this bin is we're going from 30 to 39.9999999999 continuously. Basically, we're going just to the left of 40, but then as soon as we hit 40, then we'd be in this right-hand bin and not in the 30s anymore. With reading these histograms, we get a lot of information. Like if we didn't see our original data and just had this graph here, we get an idea of where values landed in terms of these different bin widths. Also with the frequency, with the height of the bars, like what I could say here, if I'm looking at this bar that's between 80 and 90, what I can tell from that without seeing any actual data values is that there were 6 exam scores. 6 exam scores between 80 and 89.99. So without seeing the data, I do get an idea of values that came through. While I can't actually see the exact data values, we can get an idea of how many landed roughly where in the graph. So that's our histogram. Relative frequency histogram works very similarly. What's going to change is our number line for the y-axis. So x-axis is going to stay the same. We're going to jump up to 30, go 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. Oops, 110. Aw, okay. Then our y-axis changes. It's no longer frequency. Now it's going to be relative frequency. So with relative frequency, this is representing the data as percentages. So this little table that I made on the left-hand side here, it's listing our different bins that we have as we go across the x-axis. And now instead of a frequency, just counting how many fit, like with 30 to 40 or that 30 to 39.99, how there was one value, now we want to create a percentage of saying, well, there was one value out of 15 possible values. Which, if we plug that into a calculator, will give us this decimal 0.00667, which is equivalently 6.67%. And this is the percentage that we want to end up graphing. So 40 to 49.99, there was nothing, so that's 0%, 0%. 60 to 69.99 comes from calculating, well, there were two values out of the 15. So that would be a 13.33%. Same thing for 70 to 79.99. Then 80 to 89.99 will be 40% with our fraction. Then we'll have a 20%, then a 6.67%. But it's those percentages that give us our scale for our y-axis. So I need to see from 0, and the largest value I need to see is 40. So maybe I'll go by fives, like 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40. So 30 to 40, I should be at a height of 6.67. So I'll just go just above that 5 there. And there's that bar, and 0, 0. Then a 13.3, which might be about there. So just estimate as best as you can. Then the next bar should have the same height. And then 80 to 90 is at 40%, so we're going to go all the way up. And then 90 to 100 was 20%, so we're just there. And then 6.67 again. So the relative frequency table just shows us in terms of percentages. What you should notice is our relative frequency histogram looks pretty much identical to our regular histogram. What changes is our units along the y-axis, but in terms of what was the tallest column is still tallest. Smallest columns, we still have a gap 40 to 60. It's showing the same exact information. It's just our scale changed in terms of, are we just counting how many values out of our sample, or are we talking about percentage out of our sample? Percentages become handy when you're comparing groups, so that if I was comparing this class to another class, I could compare their percentages if the sample sizes were different, rather than comparing their frequencies only really work within their own sample. So these are the different ways to graph numerical data.